Good morning. Grace and peace, and welcome to Tibbetts United Methodist Church on this Easter Sunday. Today is the day that we celebrate God making a way out of no way. And if you're still living in the darkness and despair of Good Friday, don't worry, you're not alone. Encountering the empty tomb is confusing and disorienting and chaotic. And this morning, we'll continue to tell the story of that first Easter morning when the women and Peter find the tomb empty. And the two people they find standing in the place where Jesus' body had been laid say, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" This morning, as we center ourselves for this hour of worship, I invite you to ground yourself in the presence of the Spirit here in this room. If you're joining us via live stream or watching this video after it's been posted and recorded, I invite you to be aware of the presence of God in your living room, in your kitchen, wherever you find yourself tuning in, but especially within you. Aware of God's presence and promise that God does make a way out of no way. Christ is risen. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join us in the call to worship.
Beloveds, rejoice. Systems of evil cannot overcome hope. Forces of oppression cannot destroy love. Alleluia, the Holy is alive within us. Praise the God of new life, even amidst grief. Praise the God of possibility, even when all seem lost. The stone of despair has been rolled away. Christ has risen. Christ is risen indeed.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Earth and heaven in chorus say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth.
Oh! Please remain standing for the reading of the psalm. It comes from Psalm 118, verses 1 through 2, and 14 through 24. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, God's steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my might. God has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. I shall not die, but I shall live, and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Children, to join me for a time with young disciples. If you are young in age or young in heart, come on up. Esther, can you sit down? Can you sit? Great job, thank you. Welcome, good morning, good to see you. I'm so glad you're here. Can anybody tell me what day is today? What day is today?
Easter!
And what is Easter? What is Easter? What is Easter? Yeah.
The rebirth of Jesus.
The rebirth of Jesus? What is Easter? Yes, yes. What is Easter?
When Jesus rose from the dead.
Yes. Easter is the day where we celebrate life. We celebrate life. Now, what happens in the Bible, in the gospel story, is that Jesus has died, and his followers and friends, the women who had been traveling with him through his ministry, they go to the tomb where his body was laid, and it was like a cave carved out of a rock. And they had rolled a big stone in front of the cave. And on the first Easter morning, when the women got to the tomb, they saw that the stone had been rolled away. And when they looked inside, Jesus' body was gone. The tomb was empty, and there were two men standing there in fabulous outfits, in dazzling white clothes. And these two men say to the women, "He is risen. He has come back to life. And you know what? It's almost unbelievable. It's so unbelievable what the women run and they tell Jesus' disciples. And you know what? The disciples don't believe them. It's unbelievable. Now, the thing is, we actually, are you okay? Sorry. The thing is, we actually, we don't see, the Bible doesn't tell us exactly what resurrection looks like. When the women get there, the tomb is empty and he's risen. So one of my favorite theologians, this is a person who studies and reflects and ponders God. One of my favorite theologians, her name is Marjorie Suhaki, and she talks about resurrection like the sun. So this morning I have my my sunglasses. Oh no, I want to wear the pink ones. I coordinated here. I have my sunglasses. Now why do we wear sunglasses?
Because it's sunny.
Because it's sunny, but why? Yeah. Our eyes can get hurt if we look directly at the sun. That's right. We can damage our eyes. Well, what Marjorie says is that the resurrection of Jesus is like the sun. We can't see it. We can't look directly at it. The Gospels don't tell us exactly how it happened, but it lights up everything around us. Just like we can't look directly at the sun, right, because it will hurt our eyes, but we can see the sun illuminating the trees and the water and the flowers and the grass. And that is like the resurrection and Jesus in our lives. Even though we didn't see Jesus come back to life, the fact that Jesus rose from the dead illuminates everything around us. It shines a light in our hearts. And you know what that light reveals? Peace, grace, forgiveness, love. That love reminds us that we are loved by God. And we are so loved by God that no matter what happens to us, God is always with us and God will always make a way for us, a way out of no way. So what I thought is that I really thought that everybody needed their own sunglasses. So go ahead and take a pair of sunglasses and put them on. And these are for you to wear today. These are for you to wear today. And as you wear them, I want you to think about and I want you to remember. Here you go. Will you pass one back to or pass two back? I want you to think about and remember that even though we don't see the resurrection, that we don't see Jesus rise from the dead, what the resurrection is like the sun. And it illuminates all around us that God is with us, God's presence, God's hope. Isn't that awesome? We have enough? Good. Okay. Sorry y'all don't get one. Bet you wish you would have come up here now, huh? Let's pray. Will you pray with me? Let's pray. Thank you, God, for the gift of new life, of resurrection, that illuminates, that shines on us and reminds us we are forgiven, we are loved, we are free to be ourselves as you have called and created us to be. Help us remember and celebrate the joy that you love us as we are. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you all. You may go to Sunday school with Teacher Sarah. And she will bring you back towards the end of the service. So parents, guardians, caregivers, your children will return at the end of the service. And we also have nursery care if you have little ones. Carolyn will be in the nursery today. Thank you.
Our gospel reading this morning comes from the book of Luke. It is chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed by this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
God of new life, of rebirth, of renewal, of hope, of resurrection. God, no preacher can make people believe that the dead rise. Thank you for taking the pressure off me this morning. It can only be experienced. It can only be experienced. This morning, O God, we want to enter in to the experience of you bringing streams in the desert, a way in the wilderness. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of all of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Open our hearts that we would enter in and we would find the tomb is empty. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. I've been watching a TV show from the 90s. I'm not going to tell you what show it is. I'm watching a TV show from the 90s, and it's kind of my show. And so my husband, Phil, will come in every third or fourth episode and say, "What's going on?" He's not following along. Now, some of you might be feeling that way this morning because perhaps you haven't been attending church every Sunday during Lent. Perhaps you haven't been walking your own centered Lenten journey. Perhaps you missed Good Friday service on Friday. And that's okay, because what a good TV series does is at the beginning of every episode, they do a recap. And I actually used to hate the recaps. I'd fast forward. And I've come to love them because the recap actually reveals what the episode is going to be about. So it turns out the recap, though sometimes annoying for me if I've watched every single episode, is actually really helpful in preparing and centering you for the episode. Wouldn't you agree? So I'm going to give you the recap. Previously, in the Gospel of Luke, thank you so much for laughing at that. Previously, in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus was stirring things up. Jesus was posing a threat to the religious institution of Judaism, a threat to the Roman imperial rule, a threat to the fragile relationship between the Jewish leaders and the Hebrew people and the Romans that were ruling over them. Jesus was posing a threat, and he was doing this by inviting people to look within themselves, by inviting people to self-reflect, by inviting people to face their inner darkness. And what was happening is that people were facing themselves, and they were changing. And this change, this inner change, would lead to repentance, which is an outward sign of an inner change. They were living their lives differently. They started to associate with people outside of their social circles. They started to forgive those who had hurt them. They started to heal. And what happens is when somebody changes, the system around them is impacted. So Jesus is teaching and preaching and inviting people to look within, and people are changing, and the institutions, the powers that be, are being impacted, and the threat became so great that they put Jesus to death. And they thought that this would be the end. On that first Easter morning, I imagine those who found themselves at the tomb still had fresh wounds from what they experienced on Good Friday. It's only been 3 days. 3 days since they experienced, since they witnessed and they felt the betrayal, the crucifixion, the death of Jesus. Now, at the beginning of the service, I said, if you find it difficult to believe in the joy of resurrection, in the joy of the empty tomb, in the joy of new life, don't worry, you're not alone. In fact, this morning, you're in very good company because all the people who were there on that first Easter morning also had a hard time entering into the joy of resurrection. And I don't know about you, but for me, part of why I'm struggling to fully stand in the joy of new life is because the last couple years have felt like one long Good Friday. The last couple years have been so hard, so heavy. And I realize that we have actually become so good at talking about pain and suffering and grief and death that it's difficult to talk about hope and joy and peace and freedom and resurrection. And I remind myself, nothing I can say can convince you the tomb was empty that day or that Jesus did, in fact, rise from the dead. The truth is that resurrection is a personal and intimate experience and encounter with the living Christ within our own hearts. Now, if you're sitting there thinking, man, I'm not sure if I've ever experienced that, it's okay. On Good Friday, the women saw, experienced Jesus' dead body laid in the tomb. They had that lived experience. They shared it with one another. Now, there is nothing, I love when you're telling a story to someone about your own experience, your pain, your turmoil, your hurt, and you can see in their eyes if they have had a similar experience. You know that nod? I love that when I'm sharing my heart, being vulnerable with somebody, and they give me that nod. Yes, I've been there. I felt that. I know that experience. And as good as it feels to know there is someone else who knows your pain, it's equally distressing when you hear of someone's experience or you're sharing your own experience and there's a disconnect and you can't relate. It hurts. It hurts not to be able to relate to and resonate with the experience of one another. I wonder if the story, the experience of the women and Peter at the tomb that first Easter morning might shape and provoke and invite us into our own experience of resurrection. There are so many ways that we try and capture and share our experiences. Poetry, music, artwork. There are some experiences that are so difficult to put to words, we have to find another way to express them. And I imagine that the resurrection experience, well, I know it's like that. We had so many Easter songs and hymns to choose from as we were planning worship this morning. So many people have experienced this thing for themselves and have tried to capture it, to take a picture, to illustrate what it means. But again, all of the analysis and study and critical thinking and even witnessing of others' expression of experience cannot convince us the tomb is empty. We must experience it for ourselves. So the women, I love Luke's gospel, focuses in on those women. The women who had been with Jesus, had followed him in his ministry from Galilee, that were there on Good Friday, that witnessed his crucifixion, that saw his body laid in the tomb. The women's experience reveals to us something about the nature of resurrection and perhaps even something about our own experience of resurrection. The women get to the tomb that morning, and they see that the stone has been rolled away, and they're perplexed. They're confused. They approach the tomb, and they peer in, and then they're terrified. It turns out that resurrection doesn't bring clarity. It brings confusion and chaos. The women fall to the ground, and there are these two men standing there. And they say to the women, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He is not here." Now, the women's experienced Jesus' death. And resurrection has challenged all of their certainties. It's challenged the very experience they had just lived 48 hours before. It turns out that resurrection is not easily defined and packaged and understood. It turns out that resurrection is messy and mysterious and confusing. And we may not like that about resurrection. Sometimes I'd like an easy answer, like, "Come on, God, just tell me, show me the way." But there's something about the mystery of resurrection that if we actually, for a minute, allow ourselves to step and stand in the presence of hope, we begin to see that it is, in fact, all around us. And what happens is that the women, as they stand there in that empty tomb, they remember. They remember what Jesus said, that he would die and on the third day he would rise. And all of a sudden, their memory comes into their present experience and they think, "We've got to tell someone. We've got to tell someone." And so they run to the disciples and they tell them, "You will not believe this. You will not believe it. The tomb is empty and Jesus is risen." Now, I imagine the disciples there. You know, when you're in grief, oh, this is so good. I got to get a drink of water for this. When you're grieving or reeling from a loss and it hurts, you're in your pain, and someone says to you, "It's all going to be okay." Or someone says to you, "Don't worry, this is all part of God's plan." Or someone says to you, "There's a purpose. Your pain has a purpose in your life. You'll do something with this pain someday." When you are in that moment of despair and you hear any of those things, it's hard not to feel like, "Wow, you're just making an already bad situation worse. I'm already in pain, I'm already hurting. I don't believe I'm going to be okay. I know for a fact that this isn't part of God's plan. And I also cannot see a way out of my own pain and grief in despair. How dare you try and tell me that there is any hope in this situation?" I don't know about you, but for me, when I am really in pain and suffering, I call those friends who are going to sit with me in that pain. I call the people who are going to say, "Yeah, that sucks. I am so sorry you are going through this. I am here with you." The people that weep with me. The disciples are gathered there and the women show up and they're like, "Guess what? The tomb is empty." And I imagine the disciples are like, "How dare you? We are still grieving this incredible loss and now you're trying to come in and disrupt our pain and suffering with hope?" But there's Peter. Oh, this is so good. There's Peter. Peter is there. Now, we got to give Peter a lot of credit. Because on Good Friday, Peter thought he was ready to go with Jesus to prison and to death, and he said so to Jesus directly. And then Peter is given an opportunity to stand up with and for Jesus. And he can't do it. Not one, not two, but three times Peter denies knowing Jesus. And the text tells us, the Good Friday text tells us that Peter wept bitterly. The moment that he realized what he had done, Jesus looked him in the eye. And Peter saw within himself his own darkness, his own pain. I imagine Peter was so full of regret and shame and guilt. And it's a big deal that Peter was gathered with the disciples that Sunday morning. It's a big deal because Peter faced those that knew his shame. What do you do when you're ashamed? You hide. What do you do when you've messed up? You hide. But Peter went back to the disciples, and can you imagine him? Oh, man, guys, I really screwed up. If only I had the courage to stand up, maybe Jesus would still be here. I imagine him riddled with regret. And I imagine the disciples with their arms around him saying, "Yeah, you really did screw up." Peter is there with the ones who knew his shame. And Peter is the one who had experienced the inner depths of darkness within himself, the heartbreaking disappointment of betrayal. He had lived that experience, and his wounds are still fresh. And he is the one who says, "Wait a minute, the tomb is empty? Maybe I should go and see for myself." That is not a coincidence that of all the disciples gathered there, Peter, the one who has stood in the darkness, the one who has looked within, the one who has lived his worst fear coming true, who has faced his weakness, he is the one that wonders, that has a glimmer of hope and imagination. He is the one that goes to see for himself. And the text tells us he discovers the tomb is empty. Now, Peter's experience of Good Friday and Easter morning revealed to us the nature of resurrection, one being resurrection is not a reversal. We enter into the experience of resurrection carrying our own wounds of loss and suffering and betrayal. Resurrection is not a reversal. It doesn't undo our pain. Resurrection is a transformation. Resurrection is what happens when we lay down our egos, our illusions, our expectations. When we lay them down, and we surrender, and we confess, "God, we need you. We, in fact, do not have all the answers. We, in fact, do not know the way. We, in fact, do not have it all figured out." When we come to that moment, like Peter, and we face the inner darkness inside of us, then, in our vulnerability, we become open to the power and promise of being able to experience resurrection. It's actually that vulnerability that leads us to experience the transformation and joy of new life. What Peter discovers that first Easter morning, what Peter discovers is that he had had his dark, I'm going to say emotional, spiritual, psychological, rock bottom moment on Good Friday. And Peter had nowhere else to go but back to the disciples, and then he hears the tomb is empty and no one believes it. But Peter, having had this experience, Peter wonders. And Peter goes and finds the empty tomb. And in that moment, he realizes that he is free. The experience of resurrection is the experience of freedom. Freedom from our guilt and our shame and our regret and our doubt and our fear. And you know what? It doesn't mean we won't experience those things. In fact, it means that we will be unafraid to experience those things. That we will go into the darkness, to prison and to death with Jesus because we are not afraid. Resurrection is the promise that we are free from that which weighs on our hearts, our minds, our spirits, our souls. And the way we discover that freedom is by entering into our weakness, making ourselves vulnerable, and discovering there in the darkness in our weakest moment, that is where God changes and transforms us. And that is what leads us to the promise of hope and new life and freedom of the empty tomb. I got to tell you, I am grateful that in Luke's account of this resurrection story, that the women and Peter don't see Jesus standing there. And it wasn't just because it made for a good children's sermon, though it did. It feels good to me that they don't see Jesus' resurrected body. Because we don't see Jesus' resurrected body, but we do experience it. It turns out the way that we experience the spiritual, the way we experience the presence of God, is through physical touch and presence. It's through the physical trees and mountain landscape and water and the sun. It's through our relationships with one another. It's through the ordinary elements of bread and cup and oil and water. It is through the ordinary that we come to experience the spiritual gifts, the presence of God within us. And so this week, as you walk through this season of Easter and new life, I invite you to look for the physical signs of promise all around you. The nature of resurrection tells us that they are there. If only we would be open and willing and vulnerable enough to perceive them. May God bless us and walk with us and challenge us that we might too experience the promise of new life, of resurrection, of God making a way out of no way. Thanks be to God. Amen. If you have a joy or a concern that you would like for us to pray over together as a community, in the back of the pew in front of you, you'll find a green prayer card. Take a moment to fill that out, and I'll collect them during this next song. If you are with us in the sanctuary and you'd like to light a candle as a way to offer your prayer to God, you're invited at any time during the prayer or one of the songs to come and light a candle. And if you're joining us via live stream, if you would take a moment to place your joy or concern in the chat, we'll pray over those as well.
You are my all in all. Worthy is your name, Jesus.
As we continue to God in prayer, we take a moment to widen our view, to pay attention to one another. We take a moment to lift up our eyes and turn and see our neighbor. And we name aloud the celebrations and sufferings among us in our community. And in doing so, we see our neighbor more clearly, and we draw closer to our neighbor. And in drawing closer to our neighbor, we draw closer to the Spirit. We draw closer to God. And that is why we pray with and for one another. And so this morning, we'll name aloud the joys among us. And as a community, as a congregation, we'll respond, we'll receive that joy by saying, loving God, we give you thanks. And we'll hear the and sufferings of one another, and we'll receive that and respond with the words, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We turn our attention to the joys among us. For a birthday, another year around the sun, it was Jennifer's birthday this week, we give thanks. Loving God, we give you thanks. For David and Rebecca Johansson's 17th wedding anniversary today. Long time. Loving God, we give you thanks. For the joy of all of those from Tibbetts who have prayed for me, loving God, we give you thanks. For a sanctuary full of children this Easter morning, loving God, we give you thanks. This person wrote, that I am alive. What other Easter joy is there? For the gift of being alive, loving God, we give you thanks. For new life and the birth of a new cousin on Good Friday, loving God, we give you thanks. To God for filling our preacher with the Spirit's words, loving God, we give you thanks. For friends to celebrate Easter with, loving God, we give you thanks. I'm checking our chat. We now turn our attention to the concerns among us. For David, as he prepares for major surgery, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the people of Ukraine, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For friends and family members facing health challenges, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For a 7-year-old boy preparing for a psych evaluation, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Kim, for her family, who mourn her loss after losing the battle to breast cancer this week, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For people who are struggling to navigate their mental health, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Kevin, as he continues to receive treatment for cancer, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring all these things we've named aloud and what we hold in our hearts, and we come before God. Let us pray. God of new life, we confess that we're having a hard time believing, experiencing the joy and promise of the empty tomb of resurrection. We admit, O God, that our trials and tribulations and our life experiences have caused us pain and suffering. And we confess, O God, that we are afraid to surrender because we don't want to experience our worst fears coming true. We don't want to face our pain. We don't want to let go of our egos and our false sense of security. We think we need them, O God. And then you become human. And through Jesus, begin to show us a way. A way of forgiveness, a way of mercy, a way of grace. And we confess that most days we'd rather go our own way. We'd rather follow our own path. And you, O God, wait for us patiently, continuing to place a path before us. This morning, may we stand in awe and wonder with the women and Peter on that first Easter morning, who were surprised and shocked and disoriented and confused to find that you had made a way, and that death, which was supposed to be definitive and finite, was not the end for Jesus. And may we know that death is not the end for us. And may we believe that it's actually dying to ourselves, surrendering our will to you, that we can experience the power and promise and transformation of the resurrection for ourselves. Oh God, there are those of us gathered here this morning who have experienced death, who have lived through the pain and suffering of incredible loss, of a loved one, of dreams, of hope, who have lived through the pain and suffering of divorce, of broken relationships, of shame and guilt and regret, those who have been hurt and harmed and oppressed, those who have experienced emotional and physical violence by others. Oh God, there are those of us here who have experienced death and who have been transformed by the power and promise of new life that only comes through walking in that valley. Thank you, God, that we are alive. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And now, oh God, help us to not take this life for granted, but to be willing to share it generously with one another as though we have nothing to lose, because we've already lost it all, oh God, and you lost it all on our behalf, so that we could experience the joy and freedom of being ourselves, created in your image. Finding that it's in our weakness, we come to discover the power of hope, the power of new life, the power of resurrection. Encourage us, strengthen us, empower us, O God, that we would be the hands and feet of Jesus in the world, that we would be vulnerable enough to allow our own healing to take place, to allow God to heal us, and that then we would be willing to share that with one another and bring healing to the world by your grace and your power. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, the risen Christ, who lives in us and who gave us words to pray. And we pray that prayer together now. Our Father and Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Come, let us look for the living, relationships, and efforts that lead to the thriving of our spirits, our bodies, and our communities. Let us water the seeds of solidarity, tend the soils of creativity, and relish the blooming of healing. As the body of the risen Christ, we collect our offerings for the love we want to grow. You can make a contribution to the Ministries of Tibbetts online through our website or by placing your gift in the offering plate at the back of the sanctuary as you exit. Living God, the tomb is empty. Mary told us herself. Women and gender-oppressed people guide us in the way of new life. They rise, even in death's wake. They keep telling us their stories, persisting on sharing those that open and expand possibilities. Bless our offerings that we might partner with those who lead us in the way of life and cultivate heaven on earth. Amen.
As we sing together, you are invited to sing Everlasting God. Let's sing. Can she hold this for the service? Okay, thanks.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait.
Musicians, our volunteers, our liturgists, to all of you who have worked so hard to make this a meaningful service. What do you think, Esther, your first in-person Easter at Tibbetts? Pretty cool, huh? She's like, get me out of here, Mom. We're going to do something fun. I forgot I have my fun glasses on for this. We're going to sing together the Hallelujah Chorus, and this is a fun tradition of Tibbetts, and I'm particularly reminded this morning that this is not something we've been able to do together the last few years. We're going to sing the Hallelujah Chorus, and the words are on the screen, but if you're a person that reads music and you would like a copy of the music, our worship guides have music for you. They're along the sides here. Just raise your hand. If you want to sing parts, sing parts. It will be fun, and we will fill this sanctuary with the sound of our voices and praise. Let me put this guy down. Let us pray together. Will you pray with me? God of new life, of hope, of rebirth, of resurrection, thank you for the gift of the empty tomb. May we experience it and know it in our hearts for ourselves that Christ is alive within us. In your holy name, amen. Let's sing.
Hallelujah.